Hi, Commissioner Mitchell, and let me welcome you to District Dialogue. Well, this is going to be an interesting topic that we're going to be talking about. It's about the voting machine, the electronic voting machines that all of you have got questions and want answers about, kind of what it looks like in the future. With that being said, I brought along the experts that's going to talk about where we are and what's going to happen next. Just FYI, we're taping here at the Capitol, right here where the Gold Dome is. Our backdrop is with Kimberly Alexander at her office. However, Kimberly should be stopping in. She's our state representative who actually had introduced a couple of amendments to this particular voting bill. But we'll talk about all that. If Kimberly happened to step in, she happened to have ran off to do some Black Caucus stuff. We'll talk about that later, okay? Once again, let me introduce my guests. And my guest, would you please introduce yourself, I should say, and tell everybody what you do in Douglas County and how this particular electronic voting machine that you will be speaking on.
Okay, my name is Milton Kidd, by the way. I'm the elections director for Douglas County. I'm the director of elections and registration. So being part of this department, the voting units that we currently use and that we will be transitioning to are under my purview. Mm-hmm. So I have to stay abreast of the different changes that are about to take place for Georgia, especially, and for the residents of Douglas County in particular.
Got it. So your job deals with the transitioning into this possible new system that we may encounter here in the future.
Well, my office deals with the day-to-day of elections in general, and part of the day-to-day is transitioning to a new voting system because the state of Georgia has a uniform voting system, so all 159 counties, even when we transition to this new system, will be utilizing the same equipment so that no matter where you go to vote, whether it's in Douglas County, Cobb County, or Fulton County, mm-hmm. you receive the same elections experience, either advanced voting or election day.
Got it. So with that being said, even though we're doing this taping here at the Capitol, awaiting on the arrival of hopefully our state representative, Kimberly Alexander, your makeup, I mean, there's a lot of bills that's already have been passed about this particular voting machine, and we're waiting on the governor's signature. So by the time you watch this in April, during the month of April, you'll probably find that he's either signed or not signed, or kind of where we are, what the possibility of that. And I know it's more of a Kimberly question, but maybe you might have the answer to that, though.
Well, the particular bill that we're discussing is House Bill 316. Mm-hmm. House Bill 316 is a bill that the legislature introduced actually in last session, and they brought it back this session with some amendments and some different changes mm-hmm. to address the shift from what we in not just Douglas County, what we in the state of Georgia refer to as DREs, mm-hmm. which are the current voting units. Mm-hmm. So we're shifting away from DREs to a new technology called ballot marking devices. I guess the biggest difference mm-hmm. between the DRE and the ballot marking device mm-hmm. is the ballot marking device will allow voters to produce a paper ballot trail of their selections. So after a voter touches and votes on the touchscreen unit, because it'll still have a touchscreen component to it, they'll insert a piece of ballot stock. That piece of ballot stock will then print their choices, and we'll have a paper version of the choices mm-hmm. so that in the future, if there is any recounts or discrepancies okay. or things like that, mm-hmm. the paper version of your vote will actually serve as the official vote.
Now, Mr. Kidd, the biggest question out there with the general public is trying to understand this paper ballot addendum or amendment or whatever it is that's going to be a part of the machines nowadays. Am I able to take that home with me? Or kind of what is that whole process? Because, you know, the voting situation has always been about why and how can I get a piece of paper that stated who I voted for, when I voted, and all that kind of good stuff. But it appears that this is not going to be the case. So to make sure the public truly understand what that really is, what would the voting machine and or paper part of this be in the future?
Okay, the actual feel of the ballot marking devices mm-hmm. will be very much similar to the current DRE units that we have. Mm-hmm. And I think that was the initial inclination of the legislature when they were moving to a new technology to not jump ahead of the cart per se, but to have something that was an easy transition for Georgia voters. Mm-hmm. Now, with these new ballot marking devices, essentially after you've checked into that polling location, you'll be given a piece of cardstock to insert into one of these ballot marking devices.
Okay.
Your selections will come up on the screen as they normally do now.
Okay.
You'll make your selections. And previously, when a voter finished voting, they had a recap screen on the DRE units. Mm-hmm. With the ballot marking devices, it will print out the selections that you made.
Correct. But you will not be able to take that home with you. So that's
correct.
Okay. Because I think that's where people get the misconception that I'm going to take this home and put it in my Bible, and now, you know, I know what I did in 2018 and 2020 and so on.
No, though. Yeah, that's a misconception.
Okay.
The way it will work is, once that ballot is printed out, you'll then take that ballot over to some type of optical scanner and insert that mm-hmm. ballot into an optical scanner. Mm-hmm. And my office will maintain that ballot for the prescribed amount of time.
Paper.
Yes.
Okay, okay.
Now, the reason why voters won't be able to physically take home a paper ballot
Please
is...
Please explain.
Being able to take home a paper ballot essentially nullifies another essential point of our election system here in the United States, mm-hmm. and that's the secrecy of the ballot. If we allowed you to take home a paper ballot, then I would be able to identify exactly how you vote. Mm-hmm. And that's not the situation that voters actually want. The anonymity of the voting process is an essential function of our voting process. Mm-hmm. But whereas this system versus previous incarnations of the system bring into play is having that paper version that you can lay your hands on. Mm-hmm. If there is any type of discrepancy, we will refer back to those paper ballots and you won't just have to have the digital component.
Right.
So it's almost like a system of check and balances built into the system. That's probably the largest change that voters will see, mm-hmm. but there are other components of this bill that will affect overall voter confidence as well, including risk-limiting audits.
Okay.
A risk-limiting audit will be performed prior to the election and at a prescribed time frame after the election. Mm-hmm. By that, I mean we'll have the digital component of what was supposed to be cast during this election, mm-hmm. and then you'll go to the paper versions of mm-hmm. the ballots, and you'll bump those two up against each other to verify that you have exact counts.
That's getting the accuracy of both. So you guys will hang on to the paper part of this until a certain time frame, and then what, you guys will scrap it, discard it?
Well, all that we do in elections, that's what's called a retention schedule, mm-hmm. whether that's from 2 to 5 years that you're required by law to maintain elections information. Now, we'll always have the numerical information associated mm-hmm. with this election, mm-hmm. but we'll maintain those paper ballots based off of the prescribed time that the state actually comes up with.
Now, will the paper ballot identify that person?
It will not identify that person. The actual way that we currently vote, if you voted in the state of Georgia, you know that the first step after you fill out who you are and mm-hmm. show your ID, mm-hmm. you go to what's called express polls. Now, in the express poll, one of the poll workers looks up your current information,
correct.
Including your name, address, date of birth.
Yes.
That field will remain the same. Mm-hmm. That's actually how we give a voter credit for voting. Now, we maintain that system separately from the actual votes that you cast.
Okay.
So, essentially, these paper ballots will, just like the current system, go into a big jumble, so you can't say that John Smith votes this way.
Got it. But you'll at least have John Smith paper ballot.
Yes.
You know, but you wouldn't know that was John or whoever else. So, and that's when you'll kind of rally or gather up all this information and then say, okay, 100 people voted. What was on the machine? 100. And then that's the accuracy of what you're saying will come up
Yes.
with. That's putting it in layman's terms.
Yes, it's a system of checks and balances.
Got it.
If the digital count says that you have this, you have to have that same number as far as the paper ballots. Now, the paper ballots won't have any names attached
Understood.
To them.
Understood.
but you'll.
But I know the general public is expecting that piece of paper with their name on it, stating that that's who I voted in 2020, and here's who I voted for, and blah blah blah. But I see now that that's not the case. So I'm glad you're explaining this,
yes.
So that those who are expecting this in the future as to this paper ballot situation, because I guess when I'm in the general public, that's kind of what I hear.
Yes, yeah. And I think that misconception is out there in a lot of cases. Mm-hmm. But what people don't consider is most individuals don't want micro-targeting to take place, mm-hmm. essentially, mm-hmm. because people don't understand that everything that we do is open to the general public.
Correct.
So if you had some type of system where you can identify how Commissioner Henry Mitchell votes, I could go at that point
and get
your voting record. Mm-hmm. Now, the anonymity of the ballot traces back to 1776 when this country was actually established. Mm-hmm. These principles of election process, of mm-hmm. a direct democracy, mm-hmm. are fundamental principles mm-hmm. of the United States as a whole, not just Georgia, not just Douglas County.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So you had to maintain those.
I understand. So we're not actually eliminating the voting machines or eliminating this whole voting process. We're basically enhancing it to a degree of giving with those who are asking about the paper side of it. And I'm assuming that our legislators kind of found that happy medium to say, okay, we can attach a piece of equipment to do a printout or to print out a ballot of some sort, still keep the accounting side of it with the machines and kind of merging the two with software, I guess, to kind of make this come to light.
Yes, sir. The major debate out there between the voting units mm-hmm. and what are called the new ballot marking devices and paper ballots was that voters wanted to have some type of confidence that that was an immutable record, not
That's
just a digital component.
Correct.
So this printing of their ballot is that happy medium.
Mm-hmm.
But you kind of need this happy medium mm-hmm. simply because a lot of the discussion out there against having some type of digital component was going back to hand-marked ballots.
Yes.
Now, being an elections official myself, and myself and other elections experts agree that hand-marked ballots are not necessarily the best role for the citizens of Georgia, mm-hmm. simply because, in all honesty, people do all type of things as far as hand-marked ballots. Mm-hmm. There's stray marks, there's overvotes and different things. Mm-hmm. Whereas when you have the digital component that won't allow you to overvote, that won't allow you to make excess marks on a paper,
yes.
It's kind of for the advantage of the voter, mm-hmm. simply because when you have those extra marks of different things, you're taking the vote away from the voter and transferring it to what's called a vote review panel that has to try to interpret the will of the voter.
Now, Mr. Kidd, I hear what you're saying, but saying that to my mom, I want you to go and explain all that to my mom, and then because she wants the paper. She wants to actually write it down, you know, punch a hole. And
okay, I'll give you this an example. We've always had a version of paper ballots in the state of Georgia. Mm-hmm. Any official or any voter in the state of Georgia that does not want to vote with the digital component at all mm-hmm. has the right to request an absentee ballot.
That's correct.
Absentee ballots are processed, well, we begin to accept application for absentee ballots 180 days prior to an election.
Good.
So that's 6 months prior to an election, you can start to request a ballot being mailed to you. Mm-hmm. So if someone wants to mark their ballot with pen and paper, they still have that option. Where this system aids into the point of view is we process a lot of voters. The state just reached over 7 million voters mm-hmm. as a state.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a lot of individuals to move through a polling location.
I would agree. I would agree. So let me change gears a little bit. So when should we expect this process to kind of, once the governor signs and you know, makes this new law of
yes.
what we'll do, when should we expect, we're going to hypothetically say he will sign it. I don't see why he wouldn't. At what point will we start seeing this type of a process?
Okay. The large majority of Douglas County voters won't actually see this change take effect until March of next year. March of next year for Douglas County and for the state of Georgia as a whole is what's referred to as the presidential preference primary.
Okay.
It's the time frame in which we narrow down the presidential field to the particular parties and their representatives.
Mm-hmm.
But in November of this year, most of the counties in Georgia have municipal elections. The municipal elections are city elections where you have your city councils, school board, mayors, and things like that.
That's
in
correct.
The city mm-hmm. aspect mm-hmm. being elected.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So the goal of this new law is to have at least 10 counties participate in basically a pilot program in mm-hmm. this November election. Mm-hmm. And those other elections officials that are not part of the 10 counties have the chance of seeing
this in operation. This in full effect. So should we as Douglas Countyans expect this in our municipal or city elections this round in 2019, or have the counties of the test markets been announced yet?
Now, the Secretary of State's office has not announced the counties that will be part of the test market, mm-hmm. but I will say that if Douglas County is not one of the counties selected for this test market,
mm-hmm.
myself and certain key staff members will be present at whatever counties are selected mm-hmm. in order to just get a firsthand view of the new system in mm-hmm. place mm-hmm. and kind of preview it mm-hmm. for Douglas County. Now, at the time frame of a full rollout of this system, my office does plan on basically holding open house mm-hmm. Meetings in order for the general public to lay hands on the new equipment, mm-hmm. to understand it, offer an in-depth analysis
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
on exactly how this new voting system will be utilized.
That's for your office and for the general public, I guess.
Yes.
Both. But there's not much of a change outside of paper.
Outside of the paper,
okay.
where this the old voting unit was 17 years old,
mm-hmm.
you wouldn't want a cell phone.
This system has been around that long.
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
And
wow.
even before that, there's acceptance testing and things like that. So mm-hmm. the technology has been around for almost 20 years at this point. So it was time to upgrade the technology.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You have to think of it like your cell phone. You wouldn't want a 17-year-old cell phone. I know that.
I've been there, done that, yeah.
yeah.
Been there, done that, yes, yes.
I know that Apple is going to be producing a new model in
yes.
2 years.
But you know, I didn't even think about this. I was on the committees in early 2000 that dealt with these machines and dealing with Gabio. I don't know if you, the Georgia Black elected officials.
Yes.
And we went through this whole process of even coming to where we are today. I mean, not today, but what
yes.
we're using today. But now to see that it's been that long, I didn't realize it's been that long.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
The initial voting system has been around since, has been in use throughout the entire state since the 2002 election.
That sounds about right. That sounds about right. Yes. Wow. Wow. Okay. So let's talk about also, and I was expecting, as we all know, that we was expecting a Representative Alexander, and maybe you know the answer to this question. Do you know the dollars and cents that the state is going to spend to get us, from the software to the new voting process, paper and so on? Is that cost? I'm assuming they're ready for that particular cost. It's not going to be passed down to the local counties and the locals.
The governor of the state has allocated $150 million in the current budget in order to replace the election system. So the way it will work is
okay.
just like the initial rollout of the current DREs back,
yes.
way back when.
Early 2000.
The state will pick up the cost for this initial bulk of the purchase of voting equipment
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
for the counties.
And go ahead.
Now, the counties have the option of purchasing additional voting equipment, let's say down the line as counties grow, with Douglas County being one of the fastest growing metropolis.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
We may one day have to look back at our allocation of voting units. Mm-hmm. We may have to look at expanding precincts and things
mm-hmm.
like that.
Mm-hmm.
So the counties have the option of expanding, but the initial purchase will be made through state funding.
Wow. So so the funds are all there to kind of hopefully get the state off, kicked off definitely in 2020. But,
yes.
But as early as the test markets in 2019.
The test markets pending the governor's signature are scheduled to take place for the November elections of this year, mm-hmm. with the full rollout plan for March of next year.
Wow. And equipment-wise, that means, so will the makeup of the system look any different, or we don't know that because we don't even know what the mock look like?
Well, myself and other elections officials for the last year or so have been able to basically lay hands on some of the different options.
Okay.
Now, the state is currently in the process of accepting bids to replace the system. So the leading components, but the leading competitors that have been offering bids have been present at different functions across the state, including the Georgia Elections Officials Conference, and they basically showed us your wares at that time.
Got it.
So although the RFP for this won't actually close until the 23rd of next month, we kind of have an idea of where it's going.
Got it. And speaking of which, too, you spoke of earlier about a couple of precincts. I know in Douglas County we've got a precinct that's going to be changing, that's going to be happening here even in this election cycle. Talk about that particular precinct that's going to be changed so we can kind of at least make the public aware in Douglas County of that particular precinct change.
Colonial Hills Christian Academy allowed us to be a polling location for many years. Mm-hmm. That was a school attached to the church facility,
yes.
that we used as a polling location for many years. Mm-hmm. But due to unforeseen conditions, the school aspect of the church facility is actually closing.
That's correct.
So we had to transition those voters. Now, here in Douglas County, we tried to maintain a voting precinct within a 2-mile radius of a voter's house. So we were lucky enough to find and select a new facility that's right around the corner.
Yes.
Atlanta West Pentecostal mm-hmm. Church mm-hmm. that has agreed to serve as a polling location mm-hmm. for those previous Colonial Hills voters. Mm-hmm. Now, from the church's perspective, this is an opportunity for them to be of service to their community. So after meeting with church leadership, they have been excited to take on this capacity mm-hmm. as a polling location for Douglas mm-hmm. County. And they're doing it without charge or anything like that. Mm-hmm. So this is all for the benefit of the citizens of Douglas County.
Got it. And I guess, so it's good that now we're making these guys aware of it on District Dialogue today. What about the process of getting the message out about this particular polling change? Because I know during that election cycle this year, there will be a notice on the door and all this other good stuff. But there's a process that I think we spoke about that you're going to be doing and your team will do to kind of make sure the word is out. And we're going to put the word out again, even in 2020, to make sure that everybody know again. So would you share that, please?
Every voter that's affected by this change will receive a new precinct card. Mm-hmm. We'll begin within the next few weeks to start to send those precinct cards mm-hmm. out closer to the election, because this change will take place for the November election of this year. So there'll be ads running the papers. So the Sentinel will have an ad on our website. We'll have the information posted. Mm-hmm. We'll be posting signs throughout the county mm-hmm. around that precinct mm-hmm. dictating the change. There'll be signs at the old location mm-hmm. Dictating the change. We're basically taking every opportunity to let voters know and keep them abreast of all the changes that are taking place prior to the election. Now, election law does not state that we actually have to continue these activities into 2020, but with the size of the elections in 2020, we want to make sure that every Douglas County voter has the opportunity to cast a ballot. So we'll be doing these same processes again in next year's election.
So in 2020, you'll do everybody or that particular precinct?
Only the changes. You'll be part of these notices for the changes. Mm-hmm. Now, in 2020, every head of household will receive basically a notification of if you live at this address, this is your polling location.
Got it.
That's a change that will affect every household. But this particular change for this precinct, it will be targeted toward that precinct.
Got you. Now, going back to the voting machines, and we're going to wrap this thing up here shortly. So with the new makeup, and I think you mentioned this earlier, but am I able to go to one precinct or another and still vote and cast my vote and it'll catch up with where it needs to be? Or you still got to stay within the precincts that you're voting in or where you live in the precinct that you're
okay.
in?
Okay. I'll answer the question in two fashions. Mm-hmm. Election day, mm-hmm. you're still required to go to the precinct that you're assigned to.
Got it.
That's on your precinct card. That's contact my office. We'll gladly give you that information. That's going on my voter page, mm-hmm. Georgia, mm-hmm. and being able to see your precinct information. That's mm-hmm. if you wait until election day. Mm-hmm. But 3 weeks prior to every general and primary election mm-hmm. in the state of Georgia mandates early voting. Mm-hmm. So during that 3 week time frame for Douglas County, during that 3 weeks, we'll have 5 locations open. During that 3 week time frame, and voters, no matter what their district, their specific district information, can go to any one of these 5 locations and early vote. Mm-hmm. So if you early vote during that 3 week time frame, mm-hmm. you can go to any one of these locations throughout the county. But if you wait until election day to vote, mm-hmm. then you have to go to your specific precinct.
Got it. And you stated earlier, for those of us who would like to get an absentee ballot, like my mom, who would like to have this piece of paper.
Yes.
She could actually do this 100.
She can start to the next election for the majority of Douglas County voters mm-hmm. will be the March presidential preference mm-hmm. primary.
Yes.
The PPP for short.
Yes. Yes.
She can start 180 days prior to March's date, you can submit an application
Correct.
For an absentee ballot. Mm-hmm. Now, if you fit specific criteria to including elderly or disabled, that application that you do for that March election mm-hmm. will be good for that entire election season.
So it'll be automatically, you'll send this out to these guys.
For individuals that fit these two unique categories.
And military elderly, will be one of, okay.
Elderly or disabled. Military mm-hmm. is a little different.
Okay.
Military is still required to submit an application, but due to the fact that being a member of the service, they sometimes move and things like that, mm-hmm. they don't necessarily get their ballot mailed to them.
Automatically, they have to still...
Well, they don't necessarily get it automatically. If you submit for one, mm-hmm. the military is able to get what's called a UOCAVA ballot. A UOCAVA is an electronic ballot. Mm. Because we have service members that are not just in Georgia, that are stationed throughout the country, that are stationed mm-hmm. throughout the world, those service members are still able to vote. We email them their ballot.
Oh, wow.
And then they send it back to us.
Really? I did
yes.
not know that. Wow. Okay. Interesting. Okay. Wow. Well, listen, some valuable information. This is some good stuff. In closing, and again, I apologize that Ms. Representative Alexander, Kimberly Alexander, didn't make it based on her caucus meeting this morning. Any closing remarks that's dealing with these machines and the how to and what to expect? And I guess definitely how to contact you if they have questions.
Yes. You can always go to Celebrate Douglas, and we're under the Departments tab for Elections and Voter Registration. Mm-hmm. If you have any questions, we welcome all questions, whether that's on your precinct assignment, whether that's on how to receive an absentee ballot.
Right.
The application is actually on our website as well. Mm-hmm. We'll, closer to the election date for this year and next year, we'll have the locations throughout the county that you can actually go vote. Mm-hmm. We'll have links where you can go and see your specific information, including mm-hmm. absentee ballot information. Mm-hmm. It's on the website.
Yes, yes. So everything is there. So the good part is they can go to the website and get anything they need, or they can possibly give you a call and call your office.
We're
on the first floor at the county at the courthouse.
Yes.
So, and come by and see you and ask
Anytime.
All the questions that they may have. Well, with that being said, I thank you for at least sharing with the District Dialogue viewers about what's going to be happening in the future when it comes to the electronic voting machines. I think this is some good information to understand. I learned a lot just by listening to what you just stated. So again, thank you for sharing.
No problem. We're here to facilitate elections in Douglas County and make
Correct.
Sure that every voter has access to the ballot
Correct.
Box.
And it's not about Republicans or Democrats. It's about everybody have a great experience in voting and definitely and their vote is counted.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Thank you again for sharing, and thank you, my guest, Mr. Kidd, for sharing all the information about the new electronic voting that's going to be future coming here in 2019 and definitely 2020 when they'll do the full
Yes.
Georgia rollout. Thank you again, and enjoy the rest of your day. My name is Commissioner Mitchell, and thank you for tuning in to District Dialogue.